So today I'd like to share with you guys what I upgraded and also what I learned from this. Okay, so very quickly, what this project is very simple. It's a special shelf that I made. Okay, and I custom made to put ultrasonic sensors into the shelf. So it's very simple how many I have in there, because the ultrasonic is able to detect the distance. It's able to tell me how many boxes I have here. And it basically counts. And after that, it actually sends it up to the web, which I can actually check the stock status from anywhere. In a nutshell, that is what it is. So this is version 1 that was done last year. What it used was an Arduino Mega, which you can see over here. It had one PCB for the ESP8266 over here. This. I don't have my mouse. Okay, so it has one PCB here, and it has...
Ceiling's too high, right?
Yeah,
okay. So, and there's a second PCB here, which is for all the Ethernet ports. So basically how it works is that, okay, so the ultrasonic sensor goes into a second board, the first board that actually goes into an Ethernet cable, which goes into here, which goes into the ultrasonic.
So
here, maybe? I don't know.
Are you serious? That bad?
If it's too soft, then you can't hear it. I'll try moving it around.
Chimei, why don't you stand in the center when I say something and quickly say the same thing out? Okay, and it had LEDs for status indicator, which is over here. And it did not have a way to actually configure this. The biggest problem, there was no config interface. Okay, so every time I wanted to configure something, I actually uploaded a new Arduino firmware to configure it, and then after I put back the original firmware. Which was quite silly. Okay, so version 2 now uses an espresso light. So this is a ESP8266 board that is made by an expert, my good friend William Hui. So this is an ESP8266 and it has an onboard regulator on top. Okay, and I use this time round. I use multiplexers, so I do not use the entire Arduino Mega, although I have lesser pins than the Arduino Mega. I'm able to do all 16 ultrasonic sensors. I put in an OLED LED, so I do not use LED this time, and just one PCB to do everything. And we have a config interface as well. So this is the front, the back of the PCB boards. You guys do not know, I have my own PCB boards. This is the back of the shelf, which is a lot simpler than the first version. Okay, so then there was a config interface. This was the main issue that I had with the first version. I needed it to do all these. I needed to enable, disable sensors. Because there are 16 of them, I may not use all 16 at the same time. I need to calibrate each sensor, because each shelf is a different height. There's a certain calibration issue. There's a sensor mapping. So in the shelf, all the sensors are 1 to 16, but on the database, it's actually a different number. So we need to map like sensor 1 on the shelf equal to sensor maybe 25 on the web. And then we have to trigger calibration and reading. And yeah, the ability to read the current configuration from the EEPROM. Okay, so the config interface was really the thing that I wanted to have for version 2, but I had a long time that I had this problem with that. So because it's ESP8266, it uses Wi-Fi, obvious choice is the configuration should be done in Wi-Fi. But how do you squeeze a web interface into an ESP8266, which is not really that big, right? So this actually bugged me for a very long time. How do I actually going to get this done? Okay, so the trick in the end which I did and how I got it done was that the interface does not have to sit inside the MCU. The interface can sit outside the MCU. So you can host it on the web, and then on the ESP8266, only send the get command and actually send it back in. So the web page that you host can be locally, can be remotely. You can use all the JavaScript library that you want. So you can throw in like Bootstrap, jQuery, it doesn't matter. Okay. So, demo time. Oh, perfect, mirror image. So I need, you know, the...
Oh no.
Okay, never mind. So you can see if it goes wrong. Okay, so this is a local file, as you can see. It's locally hosted. I just put in the IP address of the board. Okay. And so I can do things like ping it. It will show you online. I can click get info. And this actually sends back all the configuration data of the inside the ESP8266. I can, for example, now I have sensor 1 to 16 here. So I sensor number 13, as you can see, is at 0. I can say sensor 13 enable. I click set. Okay, and I get info again. And you see sensor 13 now is going to 1. So this allows you to do all that. And I would really like for you guys to see this, but unfortunately, I don't think you can see the... Yeah, you can't really see it. Maybe later you guys can come. You can actually just click and read sensor like this.
Continue.
Yeah, no. Actually, it's very clear. Yeah. Okay, you guys are going to have to...
Is there a way to put the effects on
it? I don't know. Effects. Alien, space alien.
Okay, so by the way, the camera belongs to Saini, not mine.
Yeah. Obviously not
your
fault.
Then how do I get back to the same one?
Yeah, so space alien will
okay,
do.
Okay, okay. Anyway, so I can click read. Okay, so it actually activates the sensor and now it reads.
Wow, woo! Clap, clap, clap. Live demo.
What are you doing now?
Oh, sorry.
Okay, anyway, you guys can come and play with it later. Let me continue my presentation. Yeah. Okay, so besides this, there was another... 5 more minutes. I was actually quite surprised that I actually learned a few more things about Arduino IDE. How many of you here use Arduino? So, this thing doesn't work now. So it will be surprising because you can actually learn new things about the IDE that I didn't know. One is that there's this thing it taps in Arduino. How many of you know about this? Right. And how many of you know you can use an external editor? Okay. So let me show you. So tabs in Arduino is like you come here, you click, you can put new tab. Okay. So this, the thing that for the Smart Shell firmware, it's a very big firmware. There's a lot of things that were written. So you see here, there's things for the OLED, there's things for the calibration, there's things for the config server, there's like the EEPROM, you have ultrasonic sensors, you have the Wi-Fi, there's so many things. And what you can do when you have tabs, over to my Arduino IDE here. Okay. What happens is that you are able to put different functions into different tabs. Okay, and when you compile, right, it actually takes all your tabs, put it into one, and sends it into your Arduino. So the good thing is that, so when I talk about things about calibration, if you have a lot of functions about calibration, you know, you're scrolling all the way down and you cannot find the actual function you want, now you're able to very nicely segregate it into all the different things that you like. So when I have to change something about calibration, I have to go to calibration and I can find the function I want very quickly. It's very easy. And one thing very interesting is that you can, this is what I do, right? Who likes those kind of source code where you have you open up and you see the first thing is comment that goes like here and then code starts somewhere down there. Fantastic, right? Everyone loves those, right? Where you go down 100 lines and okay, first line of executable code. So you can actually have one tab just for documents whereby you write all the crap that you need to write. And it actually doesn't interfere with you, but you can find back your documentation actually much faster. Okay, and the external editor is actually very simple. You just go to here and you go to preferences and you just click use external editor here. And what this allows you to use something like Atom or Sublime Text or whatever you want. And you get all the nice functions from the IDE that you have in Sublime or in Atom. And after, all you need to do is, like, let's say we change something here, right? Calibrate sensor. This is a command. Okay, I just save this. This is in the calibrate tab. So I go back to calibrate. This will appear here. Right. And then after that, you just click compile and you just send it to your Arduino. So you still, in the Arduino IDE, you still able to use the serial monitor and everything that you are familiar with, but you're able to use something like Atom, which allows you to code faster. So when I was writing all these lines of code, I was using mostly Atom, which allows me to actually, Thanks. Yeah, so, things like, the thing that was really, really, actually the number one feature that is not inside the Arduino IDE that's inside Atom is variable name completion, which is very irritating. So things like current read, you don't really need to keep remembering variable names, which Atom will actually auto-complete for you, which is very nice. And naturally, in Atom, you have a plugin for Arduino as well. So it has Arduino syntax highlighting and all that for you. Yeah, so this is something new that I learned. I think a lot of people do not know that the IDE has this. So even basic stuff sometimes, I think it's interesting that we can share here in Hackware as well. Yeah. 1 minute, 35 seconds. I can take one question if you have, maybe. No? Okay. You guys want to look at the circuit boards after that? Feel free to come and find me. I'll be here.
What is